In addition to political strife, there was a considerable religious tension. So, in addition to political strife, there was also considerable religious tension. The majority of Irish, including the Joyces, were Catholics and strongly favored Irish independence. The Protestant minority, on the other hand, mostly wished to remain united with Britain. So they were divided on this question of Irish independence. There was one group that wanted to stay connected with this British royalty. They were the royalists. And on the other side, there were people who wanted a clean break from the British supremacy or British monarchy. So see, it was connected with, like, you know, the majority of the Irish, including the Joyce's, okay, that means James Joyce's family. They were Catholics and they wanted independence. They did not want to have anything to do with with Britain or with the British rulers. They wanted their own nation. The Catholics wanted their own nation. But the Protestants, okay, they were a minority and they wanted to remain united with Britain. They wanted to be, they did not want to lose this connection that they had with Britain. So, I mean, this is not only politics, it is also very much connected with this whole question of religion and church. The church also had a say in these matters, okay? So, as it goes, see, the Protestants who were in the minority largely favored continuing the British rule, while the Catholics favored home rule or creation of a separate Irish parliament. And in connection with this situation, there was one politician, one particular statesman called Charles Stuart Parnell. He was a Protestant statesman. And he led the Irish nationalist movement for home rule. Okay. So Joyce's family, being Catholics, they were on the side of people who wanted home rule. And they supported Charles Parnell, who was a Protestant statesman, but who wanted home rule. Okay. Now, in the home rule in the 1880s, but he died in 1891 without achieving his goal and having lost his leadership role after being discovered to be an adulterer. So he was very popular with the people until it was discovered that he had an extramarital affair, which became a scandal, and he lost his position. Okay, he lost his favor with the people, and that led to, you know, the fall of this whole movement for getting Irish home rule. Nevertheless, Parnell would become a symbol of rebellion amongst the Irish for many decades to come, and his ideas are discussed by fictional The Dedalus Family in A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man. So you find this, the political ideas of Parnell and his support and people who opposed him, this whole thing, this controversy being talked about in the family that we meet in this novel. That is Stephen Dedalus. He's the central character in this novel. Stephen Dedalus' family, okay, talks about what happens with Parnell, and they take sides also. So especially because the father, you know, the father character that you meet in this novel, he also, in actually James Joyce's actual life, his father was very much connected with the whole political enterprise of Charles Parnell. And when Charles Parnell went out of favor, it actually saw the end of James Joyce's father's political career also, and after which he took to a lot of drunkenness. He has experienced that. And so you find all that being reflected in this novel that he writes. So Joyce's life. There are autobiographical elements present in A Portrait. So from what I was just telling you, you already might have understood that there are autobiographical elements in this novel. Now let's go into more of Joyce's life to find out what are the autobiographical elements that we can find connections with. The first of 10 of John Stanislaus Joyce and Mary Murray Joyce, James Joyce was born in Dublin on 2nd of February, 1882. Joyce's family's frequent changes of residence is an important aspect of Joyce's life that has a bearing on the novel. Even in the novel, you find this character shifting quite frequently, as happened in Joyce's own life, because his father having lost his career with the politician Panel, lost everything, went into alcoholism, and it was, and they had so many children also. I think 13 children they had, and 10 of them survived, and James Joyce was the eldest one. So that meant that, they had to keep shifting to smaller and smaller houses because the family was getting poorer and poorer day by day. So James Joyce's frequent change of residence is an important part that you see played in the novel also. Now, in his real life, see, he first went to Cork, a place in Ireland, then to Blackrock. The family often moved many times within Dublin. I think around 9 times or so they moved within Dublin itself. Joyce's early education, first at Clongowes Wood College, Belvedere College, Dublin, which was like the subsequent schooling that he had, and later on University College, Dublin, from where he received his BA degree in 1902. So the first school that he went to was Clongowes Wood College, and then he went on to Belvedere College in Dublin. Then he went on to the University College Dublin, where he got his BA degree in 1902. He then went to Paris. The idea was to study medicine, but he did not like it. And also he could not continue to study because of financial reasons. The family resources were getting terribly depleted. Also, there was another reason. His mother was on her deathbed, and he had to immediately return to Dublin. So in 1903, his mother was on deathbed, and he went back to Dublin, stayed there till 1904, when he returned to Paris with Nora Barnacle. So this girl who was a chambermaid, Nora Barnacle, it is said that the minute he saw her, he fell in love with her, and they decided to be together as partners. So when he came back to Ireland, when he came back to Dublin in 1903, when his mother was sick, he stayed there till 1904. And later on, when he went back to Paris, it was with Nora. And he got legally married to her in 1931. So for years, they lived together as partners. And in 1931, he got legally married to her. What attracted him to Nora was her innocence. And in 1905, Joyce moved to Trieste is in Italy, where he taught at the Wurlitz School. His son Giorgio was born in 1905. His daughter Lucia was born in 1907. The year 1906 saw Joyce doing a short stint as a foreign correspondent in a bank in Rome. He went to Italy, got a job. First, he was a teacher in Wurlitz School, and then he went on to become a foreign correspondent in a bank in Rome. Later, he went to Ireland, where he stayed on till 1910. And after that, with the start of the World War, he again left Ireland. By that time, he had become completely disillusioned with all the situations in Ireland, be it political, be it religious, be it as far as his art is concerned. He became thoroughly disillusioned. And so he decided to move to Zurich in Switzerland, which was a neutral country. So in 1915, the Joyce family moved to Zurich. Although he had moved to Paris during the publication of Ulysses, the outbreak of the Second World War brought him back to Zurich in 1940, where he died and where he was buried. He had a lot of health conditions, especially connected with his eyes. I think he had around 9 or 10 operations on his eyes. And for that reason, he went back to Paris. And that was also the time when Ulysses was published, and also when the Second World War broke out, he again went back to Zurich, went back to Switzerland, and lived there till he died. And that is where he was buried also. So this is in very short, about the life of James Joyce. You can read in more detail in your book, or even look for other sources and read more about James Joyce's life. Okay. Now going to the next aspect here. Joyce's works of fiction, Dubliners, it's a collection of stories which was published in 1914. A Portrait of Artist as a Young Man was published in 1916. And Ulysses was published in 1922. And this book called Finnegan's Wake, it took about 16 years to complete, and it was called a work in progress. This was published in 1939. The aspects of Joyce's life that find echo in the novel.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes. Yes.
Ma'am, actually, your slide is stuck.
Pardon?
Your slide is stuck, ma'am, on the Joyce's life.
Okay.
It can't be seen.
Okay, let me go back and read. Can you see it now?
Not yet,
Hello.
Ma'am.
Hmm?
Not yet.
Not yet?
No, ma'am.
Let me stop sharing and go back to it. Right. Can you see it now?
No, ma'am.
Yes.
Maybe it's
no
network problem from my side. Maybe I can't see any
Can
slide.
Can others
now.
See it?
No.
Can others?
No. I guess there is some network problem. Even I'm also not seeing anything.
Okay. I'll do one thing. I'll exit from the class and come back. Okay. Let's see if it works, huh?
Okay, ma'am.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, let me share my screen. Okay, I think I'm already sharing my screen. Let's hope you can see it now. Are you all able to see it now?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. I'm able to hear you, and I guess you're able to see me too, right?
No. We can see your DP, ma'am.
Yeah, that's enough, right? Because I mean, I'm using an iPad, so when I present, when I share screen, the video gets switched off automatically. So I do one thing then. I mean, can no one see, or can at least some of you see?
Actually, when that girl was saying no, we were able to see. I was not having problem.
Okay, so some of you can still see this, right?
Yes, share screen, ma'am. Then we will see.
I am sharing screen.
But not a print, no? PPT, your PPT.
Yeah, I am sharing screen right now.
slow physical birth.
Let me try again. Can you see now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Now it is
easy. Yes,
okay. Okay. All right. So let's continue.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I was talking about the various works that Joyce has written. We talked about Dubliners, which was published in 1914. Then Portrait of the Artist came in 1916. Ulysses in 1922. Finnegan's Wake. Oh, which took like a long time to get written. It took like 16 years to be completed. That was published in 1939. Now, what are the aspects of Joyce's life that you can find in the novel? Okay, let's look at that. One is like the large size of Joyce's family, his brothers and sisters. Like I told you earlier, they were around 13 and three of them passed away and 10 of them were there and Joyce was the oldest. So that you find in this novel also, okay, this large size of
yes, ma'am.
Family, then family's poverty and its frequent changes of house. All these are elements that happened in Joyce's life, which you find, which you find in this novel, The Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man also. Then Joyce's love of city life and his Europeanized outlook, his distrust of violent politics, his flair for languages, and his general unease with institutions of various kinds. So these are elements from his own life that you find echoed in the character of Stephen Dedalus from the novel Portrait of the Artist. That the European literary time, you know. So Joyce admired Ibsen's work. Yeah, so the European literary context. Joyce's admiration was there for Ibsen's work. Henrik Ibsen, he was a dramatist and he wrote this very famous play called The Doll's House. Okay, it was about this housewife, you know, trying to step out of the shadow of her husband and trying to find an identity of her own. And the last scene in that drama, in that play, The Doll's House, is of the central character walking out of a house and slamming the front door, which was like, you know, a big thing as far as literature was concerned, because he was someone who brought, you know, brought out the reality of the modern situation. And James Joyce really appreciated the work of Henrik Ibsen. So Joyce admired Ibsen's work. And another influence on him was Arthur Symonds' 1899 book called The Symbolist Movement in Literature. So Symbolist Movement in Literature, when you talk about that, we have to talk about two French symbolists, Stephen Mallarmé and Charles Baudelaire. They were two French symbolists who also, you know, was very much connected. They both of them are very much connected with the symbolist movement. Now, Baudelaire gave new dimension to poetry related to the city, and Mallarmé's symbolism contained a shift from a romantic to a modern, ironic aesthetic, which was both appreciated by Joyce. The naturalism that Joyce inherited from Ibsen and also Emily Zola came to be thus tempered by symbolism. So the naturalistic style that he appreciated in Ibsen and also Emile Zola, came to be, you know, tempered with, that came to be flavored with symbolism. So Arthur Symonds' 1899 book, The Symbolist Movement in Literature, was something that influenced him. In that book, you find mentions of the work of French symbolist Stephen Mallarmé and Charles Baudelaire. So all of these were influences that went into the shaping of Joyce's mentality or Joyce's personality as a writer. Now, another thing that influenced him was Impressionism. Impressionism also influenced Joyce, though not as directly as naturalism and symbolism did. Impressionism made language an experiential activity rather than a descriptive activity. We talked about this in my previous class also. So Impressionism came from art, okay? Like, you know, the experience of seeing something, the impression that it leaves on us. That is what they tried to, that's what these Impressionist artists tried to paint. And the same kind of thing was tried by artists in, by writers in their writing also. So Impressionism made language something that we experience, not a descriptive activity, not just describing what you see, but also going deeper than that to talk about how you experience something. So when you talk about your experiences, it becomes something that is more inner, right? Something which is more connected with what we think. So in this respect, we can say it paved the way for the stream of consciousness technique. So that is what, when you talk about James Joyce, you cannot avoid talking about the stream of consciousness technique. So when you talk about Impressionism in language, which becomes very experiential, definitely that was a step which led the way to the stream of consciousness technique, which was partially used by Joyce in A Portrait, then in Ulysses, and in Finnegan's Wake. So stream of consciousness technique, okay? This is about a process where through the psychological principle of association, a series of thoughts or images, one leading to the next, are joined in a train of thought. Okay, so that way of writing, where the writer, when, I mean, we also think like that, right? Suppose you think about something. What do you think? Let's see. You think about an apple or an orange or the igloo class, okay? You don't think about that in isolation, right? Whenever you think about something, definitely there are other memories that are attached to it. There are other thoughts that are attached to it that come together with it, right? So that's what this is basically. The stream of consciousness applies to a process where through the psychological principle of association, we are associating one thing with another. An apple is probably associated to maybe a nice dish that you had, or maybe the picture of an apple tree, or something like that. Anything. I'm just using that as an example. So through this principle of association, a series of thoughts or images, one leading to the next, are joined in a train of thought. Best example would be to ask you to think about your childhood. Okay, think about one memory from your childhood. Do it now when I'm saying. So think about one memory from your childhood. Does that memory come in isolation? Maybe it is your mother or father, or I mean, anyone giving you a sweet. When you think about that, right, you think about the sweet itself, right? And then you think about the person who gave it to you. Then the memories connected with them come. So this is an associative process where one thing leads to another. So typically this way of expressing, where one thing can lead to another, that is what we call as a stream of consciousness technique. Is that clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So with the,
yes, ma'am.
With the form of, okay, good. With the form of narrative called interior monologue, that employs an associative process, the author's intrusion into his narrative gets reduced to a minimum. He goes with the flow. The author learns to let go and go with the flow of thoughts. He does not. Otherwise, suppose you're writing anything, okay? Just try writing, okay? So anything, you know, immediately. There is a mental process that goes on, right? When we write, for example, you're writing an answer. You write one sentence and then you think of something else, but you decide, okay, that's not going into my answer. I have to take that away and put this sentence that I think is better. So what is happening there? You are removing things, right? There is something like a removal process going on, something like an inner sensor editing what your thoughts are. But if you learn to let go of that, you know, this interior monologue that is part and parcel of our process of thought, that gets added on to this process of writing. So that actually reduces the narrator's intrusion very much. And lets the, you know, narrative speak for itself. So that's what happens in a stream of consciousness technique. And Virginia Woolf, who was born very close to actually James Joyce in terms of dates, Virginia Woolf was to later use the stream of consciousness technique in novels like Mrs. Dalloway, 1925, and to the Lighthouse in 1927. And James Joyce, he was also very much influenced by Flaubert. Flaubert, who was the author of Madame Bovary, another very important work. So these were the influences that shaped up James Joyce's thoughts. Now going to English language, it was a time of modernism. Okay, as far as literary ideas are concerned, this was a time of modernism. And Eliot, Pound and Joyce benefited not from a single influence, but from a variety of influences. T.S. Eliot, Ezra Pound and James Joyce. These are the writers we're talking about. So Eliot, Pound and Joyce benefited not from one single influence, but from a variety of influences. Joyce benefiting from the various artistic and literary tendencies operating at that time, went on to influence Eliot. So they were influencing each other also. Not only were they influenced by a variety of other influences, they were actually influencing and inspiring each other also. So what affected fiction affected poetry. Most writers of the time, poets and novelists alike, were quite eclectic in their borrowings. Eclectic means very choosy. It's not like they took everything from somewhere. They were very choosy about what they felt influenced enough to take. Now, what influenced them basically is a French symbolist movement, which we talked about earlier. Going back to it, see, French symbolism or the symbolist movement, what is it? See, for most literary historians and for our present purposes, the term symbolist movement refers specifically to a group of French writers. So we talked about how one of the influences for James Joyce was this Arthur Symonds' book about the symbolist movement. And we're talking about the symbolist movement here. For most literary historians, see, the term symbolist movement refers specifically to a group of French writers, Charles Baudelaire, Stephen Mallarmé, and Paul Verlaine. Arthur Rimbaud also, and a few other writers. Broadly speaking, these poets exploited an order of private symbols in a poetry of rich suggestiveness rather than explicit signification. So their poetry used a lot of symbols which suggested deeper layers of meaning. So they did not go for explicit signification. They did not go for outright signification using words or things. Rather, they used images and symbols to suggest deeper layers of meaning. A major contribution of this group to 20th century literature was that they brought the modernist city into focus. So many of them wrote about the city. So the modernist city came to be seen through the eyes of these French symbolists. Poets like Arthur Rimbaud, Charles Baudelaire, etc. Also, another movement that again influenced James Joyce's thoughts was Impressionism. Now, you can see the painting on the right side of the screen. Okay, this is a painting by Claude Monet, an artist called Claude Monet, and it's titled Sunrise, painted in 1872. If you look at it, okay, through realistic eyes, we can say that it's not really a sunrise. But if you kind of, you know, see it as the impression of sunrise created in the viewer, then you find that it's a beautiful depiction of sunrise, right? Because when you look at it, look at the painting there, the impression of sunrise, the feeling that you would get if you were standing there by the water, seeing the ripples on the water, seeing the lone man in a boat, you know, in a canoe in the middle of the water. And through the light shadings in the upper half, you can see that there are factory chimneys and smoke coming out. And then you can see the sun as just an orange dot. You can also see how the rising sun has colored the sky orange and also the reflection on the water. Although nothing is definite, right? Nothing is painted definitely. We get the impression of the time and the atmosphere through looking at that painting. This is what Impressionism is. So Impressionists were a school of painters who wished to depict the fleeting impression from a subjective point of view. Precise representation was not such a great concern for them. The consequence that Impressionism had for fiction writing was the transfer of interest from external reality to the inner life of the characters. So what happens in the plot doesn't become like a series of things happening from A to B to C. It rather becomes the journey in the interior or the inner life of the character. So they try to show that this is the change that Impressionism brought upon writers. So taking excuse from Impressionism in the field of art, the writers also try to talk about the interiority of the characters through words. Then going to the other movements that influenced Joyce, we can say naturalism. So what is naturalism? In fiction, naturalism is associated mostly with the work of the French novelist Emile Zola, who lived from 1840 to 1902. It was an offshoot of realism and aimed at offering an even more accurate picture of life than realism did. The naturalists believed that the novel should be based on scientific knowledge, and the writers themselves should be scientifically objective and exploratory in their approach to work. So this also implied that the environment being portrayed should be treated with exactitude. Okay, so if Impressionism was all about the experience of standing in a particular, like of experiencing something, naturalism was all about exactitude, was even more like, you know, they're writing like the realist. It had to be something based on scientific knowledge and exactitude, something exact, something very accurate. Now, the other thing that influenced James Joyce was the stream of consciousness. Okay, now when did this come into being? Okay, there was this writer called William James who used the phrase in his Principles of Psychology. William James, himself a psychologist, had written this book called Principles of Psychology in 1890, and he was the first one to use this phrase stream of consciousness. And it was used to describe the unbroken flow of perceptions, thoughts, and feelings in the waking mind. So there is an unbroken flow of thoughts that keep happening in our waking mind. It must be there. If you analyze yourself, you feel, isn't it? Inside of you, you feel there is someone always talking to you, right? Your mind, even while you're listening to me, there is a voice within your head that seems to be talking to you, right? That's a different thing. So this word came to be used by William James first in 1890 in his book Principles of Psychology, where he talked about this unbroken flow of perceptions, thoughts, and feelings that happen in our mind that is awake. The term later came to be adopted to describe distinctive narrative method in modern fiction. The novels of Dorothy Richardson, James Joyce, and Virginia Woolf are often seen as examples of this method. Somewhat influential in bringing about this approach to fiction writing are some of the time-related theories of William James himself and of the French thinker Henri Bergson. So basically, it is an unbroken flow of thought in a mind that is awake, so stream of consciousness. So French symbolism, what are the things that we saw? See, French symbolism, Impressionism, naturalism, stream of consciousness. So when you talk about the writings of James Joyce, these are things that you should know about. Now let's go to the genre, overall structure, and point of view that you see expressed in this. So a portrait in terms of genre can be seen as an aesthetic autobiography in the tradition of the Bildungsroman. It has something in it of the Kunstroman, artist novel as well. And Bildungsroman is a novel of formation. We go into more details about these terms very soon. So just remember these things, okay? When you talk about this novel, A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man, in terms of genre, you can see this as a particular kind of novel, okay? It's seen as an autobiography. It's seen as an aesthetic autobiography, like the Bildungsroman, Okay, Bildungs Roman is a novel of formation, coming of age novel sort. And it has something in it of the Kunstl Roman. So it's not just a mere coming of age novel, it is something of a Kunstl Roman, German terms, okay, which is an artist novel. It's of an artist coming of age, actually. That's what Kunstl Roman is. Now, Patrick Parender calls a portrait an ironic autobiography, and Suzanne Nalbandian calls it an aesthetic autobiography. So, two critics calling it, you know, different things. One says that it's an ironic autobiography, another one says that it's an aesthetic autobiography. So what kind of an autobiography is it? So, see, though autobiographical elements are strongly present in a portrait, it's not straight autobiography. Stanislaus Joyce, the writer's brother, has stated, "My brother was not the weak infant who figures in the portrait of the artist. He has drawn, it is true, very largely upon his own life and his own experience. But a portrait of the artist is not an autobiography, it's an artistic creation." So it's not just a straight autobiography, no? It's an artistic creation. An autobiography is just like, I mean, it can even end up being a memoir. But then this is not like that. His brother, James Joyce's brother, Stanislaus Joyce himself, has said that my brother was not the weak infant who figures in Portrait of the Arts. The character that you meet in the early part of this novel, an infant who's portrayed as weak here, my brother was not like that. And not only so that, he has, though he has drawn a lot from his life, you can't say that it's a straight autobiography. It's an artistic creation. First and foremost, it's an artistic creation. So that is how we know of the story. Now, a portrait has in it elements of both Bildungs Roman and Kunstl Roman. Let me explain that more. In a portrait, the autobiographical element, which is very significant ingredient, is consciously and painstakingly recast into a mode of depersonalization, objectification, and mythification. Joyce is able to heighten naturalistic detail onto a dramatic plane of symbolic art. So every thing that happens to the central character in the novel is heightened into a dramatic plane of symbolic art. It becomes symbolic of something that he's going through. So it acquires deeper meaning in that context. So the autobiographical element is very consciously and painstakingly recast into a point where the personal element is actually depersonalized to a level of acquiring symbolic meaning in whatever happens in the novel. Okay? Do you understand what I'm saying? Like, put in single... Yeah, put in simple terms, what I'm saying is that whatever happens to the central character in the novel, you can say that, you know, it acquires a symbolism which gives a deeper meaning to whatever happens in the novel. So that is how you can say that, you know, though it has all these autobiographical elements, it's not simple autobiography. It's an artistic creation. And as far as an artistic creation is concerned, we can say that though it is a Bildungs Roman, though it's a novel in the genre of Bildungs Roman, it's primarily a Kunstl Roman also. Now we have to understand what these two terms mean. Okay, first let's see what is Kunstl Roman. See, it's a German word which means an artist's novel. It is in the class of a Bildungs Roman or an apprentice novel that deals with the youth and development of an individual who becomes or is on the threshold of becoming a painter, a musician, or a poet. So like a Bildungs Roman, like a novel of coming of age, like a novel of growth, Bildungs Roman basically is that. It is also the same thing. Yeah, but the difference is that here it is the youth and development of an individual who becomes an artist. By an artist, I don't mean one who paints, okay? It can be a painter, a musician, a poet, a writer, one who is involved in the artistic field. So the classic example is James Joyce's Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man. So if you're asked for an example of Kunstl Roman, the best example that you can give is a Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man. Now, what is the difference? So So see, unlike many Bildan's romance, where the hero often dreams of becoming a great artist, but settles for being a mere useful citizen, Kunsthal romance usually ends on a note of arrogant rejection of the commonplace life. So that is the difference, you know, the Kunsthal romance with Bildan's romance. In Bildan's romance, also, this is the story of a hero coming of age, coming to maturity, coming to an understanding. So what happens in a Bildan's romance is that the hero, also, though he dreams about becoming a great artist, he settles for becoming a more useful citizen. So mere useful citizen. That kind of solves the issue for a character in a Bildan's romance. But in a Kunsthal romance, the artist aiming to become an artist ends on a note of rejection of the commonplace life. Does not settle for a commonplace life. Rather, the ending usually in a Kunsthal romance is how he rejects every aspect of a commonplace life and goes forward on his own chosen path, which is what you will find here also. Now, again, going deeper into this, so see, Bildan's romance, class of novel that depicts and explores the manner in which the protagonist develops morally and psychologically. The German word Bildan's romance means novel of education or a novel of formation. Bildan's romance traditionally ends on a positive note, though its action may be tempered by resignation and nostalgia. So generally, a Bildan's romance ends on a positive note, and in the action that you find in the novel, there is an element of resignation, or even a wishful, hankering for the past and nostalgia. If the grandiose dreams of the hero's youth are over, so are many foolish mistakes and painful disappointments, and especially in the 19th century novel, a life of usefulness lies ahead. So all the fancy notions that the character had as a young man becomes clear, and there are mistakes that get sorted out and disappointments also. But then at the end of the Bildan's romance, what the character looks forward to is a life of usefulness. In the 20th century and beyond, however, the Bildan's romance more often ends in resignation or death. So times were changing. The world was changing. It was not a period of a world rocked by the world wars, where every sense of firmness or steadiness or stability was lost, right? People no longer could think in those terms anymore. So in the 20th century and beyond, the Bildan's romance most often ends in resignation or death. Classic examples include Great Expectations by Charles Dickens, Anne of Green Gables in 1908 by Lucy Maud Montgomery, Sons and Lovers in 1913 by D.H. Lawrence. So the world was changing, right? In Dickens' time, industrialization happening, like imperialism happening, big world itself getting into, a major war. All of these things were happening. So the traditional Bildan's romance moved beyond what it was, where the character often wanted just a life of usefulness, and went on to acquire a different color, where the life of the central character often ends in resignation or death. A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man, autobiographical novel by James Joyce, published serially in The Egoist in 1914-15 and in book form in 1916, considered by many the greatest Bildan's romance in English language. The novel portrays the early years of Stephen Dedalus, who later reappeared as one of the main characters in Joyce's Ulysses in 1922. We talked the same thing about Charles Marlowe in The Heart of the Darkness. We said that he was a favorite raconteur of Jim Conrad, right? The same thing happened here also, that is Stephen Dedalus, who appears in A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man, reappears in Ulysses also. This was a novel that was published serially in this magazine called The Egoist between 1914 and 15. I mean, Joyce, when he wrote this book, you know, had trouble finding a publisher. Many people could, it was so far ahead of its time that many people who read it could not understand anything about it. It was not an easy book to read. So there were publishers who rejected him, saying that I will not publish anything that I don't understand. So finally, it was, I think, Pound and some of his other friends were the ones who helped him to find publication in this Egoist between 1914 and 15, and it was came in serial form, you know, serialized publication. So that was how the book came out. And Stephen Dedalus is a central character, and what we are going to talk about is how he develops from infant stage to the time when he realizes what is his true purpose in life. So each of the novels, five sections, is written in a third person voice that reflects the age and emotional state of its protagonist. So Stephen Dedalus is a central character, or we can say the protagonist. And five sections is written through the third person narrative. Okay, what is a third person narrative? First person, when you use first person narrative, I comes there. I, me comes there. But if it is third person, it is like he, she, etc. Okay? Third person narration. So it is written in third person voice, and it reflects at each stage in the central character's life, the voice of narration changes. Because if Stephen is narrating to us from his babyhood days, he talks to us like a baby would talk, and then as a boy would talk, and then as an adolescent would talk. So the third person narration changes according to the emotional state of the protagonist. From first childhood memories written in simple childlike languages to Stephen's final decision to leave Dublin for Paris to devote his life to art, which is written in abstruse, it means hard to understand, Latin sprinkle stream of consciousness prose. So this is the way the novel is structured. Now we will go into a deeper analysis of the structure. First, going more into, you know, what is a stream of consciousness technique? It's a narrative technique in non-dramatic fiction intended to render the flow of myriad impressions, visual, auditory, physical, associative, and subliminal, something in our subconscious that impinges on the consciousness of an individual and form part of his awareness along with the trend of his rational thoughts. When we think of anything, the memory, okay, of anything, all of these things become part of the memory, right? Imagine something in your memory, okay, from maybe your childhood. When you think of it, okay, it does not come without a body of its own, right? It comes with how you saw that memory, the visual aspect of the memory is there, the auditory, the sound aspect of the memory is there, the very physical sensation of that memory is there, and how that is connected with other memories, associated with other memories is there. Also things associated with your subconscious, all of these things form part of the consciousness of an individual. And it colors, you know, it colors what his rational thoughts are. It kind of, you know, talks about what's trending in this rational thoughts. Now this term, as we discussed earlier, was first used by the psychologist William James in Principles of Psychology in 1890. As the psychological novel developed in the 20th century, some writers attempted to capture the total flow of their characters' consciousness rather than limit themselves to rational thoughts. So how can we, so the writers were thinking, how can we go deeper than just what, as a writer, when we talk about a character, we can write about what the character does, what the character says, right? But then how can we talk about the interior thoughts of the character? This is what the writers wanted to find out, the total flow of a character's consciousness. How can we do that? They wanted to delve into that, and for that the psychological novel became quite useful to represent the full richness, speed, and subtlety of the mind at work. the writer incorporates matters of incoherent thought, ungrammatical constructions, pre-association of ideas, images, and words at the pre-speech level. All of these aspects were incorporated into the novel, something which had never been done until then. Incoherent thought, you know, thoughts which are not clear, incoherent thoughts, ungrammatical constructions. It did not matter, okay, because this is what is coming in our mind. Free association of ideas. So you can find, you know, the writer jumping from one thing to the other totally irrationally, because it's connected with the free association of ideas. And words at the pre-speech level, all of these things were part of the stream of consciousness way of writing, way of narration. Stream of consciousness novel commonly uses the narrative technique of interior monologue. Probably the most famous example is James Joyce's Ulysses, 1922, a complex evocation of the inner states of the characters, Leopold and Molly Bloom and Stephen Dedalus. So the best example of stream of consciousness technique narration is it, Ulysses, James Joyce's own book, Ulysses, which came after A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man. If it is a drama, for example, you know, how can they show what the author is, what the character is thinking? Example, Shakespearean drama. How do they show how a character is thinking? So there are these monologues, right? So soliloquies are there, monologues are there, or asides are there. When a character, we the audience can hear what the character is thinking, but the other characters on the stage are not supposed to hear what they are saying. So like that, you know, the novelists wanted to find out how they could express what is happening in the mind of the character, stages of evolution of thoughts in the mind of the character. Now going again to the structure of the novel. See, overall structure of the novel. Okay, there are five chapters, and the first chapter of A Portrait shows Stephen's development from infant awareness to the first assertion of his identity in an act of protest against injustice. In the first chapter, this is what happens. So Stephen's development, he is an infant in the beginning. When the novel opens, he is a baby being told infant stories. Baby stories by his parents, and then he is sent to school, and in school you know, he's punished by his teachers and he protests against that. So that is what you see in the first chapter. Okay, so each chapter is divided into sections also. So that is the first part of it. In the second chapter, shows the growing isolation that comes with his adolescence. The boy is growing, he's becoming an adolescent. And you can see that it comes with this growing sense of isolation, the sense of loneliness that he feels. And it culminates in the encounter with the prostitute. So this is also the time he's becoming aware of his sexuality. He wants to experiment and discover what these feelings are all about. And so it ends with an experience with a prostitute. In the third chapter, it represents the crisis of adolescence and a temporary toying with the idea of taking up priesthood as a vocation. So once he goes to the brothels and, you know, finds out about his own sexuality with prostitutes, he becomes guilty. He develops this feeling of guilt. So this crisis of adolescence happens with not only mingled with feelings of, you know, guilt at having done what he did, and also trying to make amends for it. And he thinks that taking up the life of a priest would be a suitable vocation for him. He toys with that. He plays with the idea of taking up priesthood. The fourth chapter represents the climax of the development in his recognition of his true vocation. So then he realizes, as soon as he decides that he is going to take a priesthood, he realizes that is not for him. Okay. And in the fourth chapter, we see Stephen Dedalus reaching almost the climax, okay, of his development of what is it that he actually wants to do in his life. he comes to an understanding of what he wants to do. He's ready to stand on his own and reject what he doesn't want in order to find himself. And in the fifth chapter, his development and his declaration of his creed of freedom becomes complete. He finds his own stand as an artist, as a creative person who wants to devote the rest of his life to creating, art. That is what you see in the fifth chapter. And talking about again the structure, actually, one of the years, this was a question, how can you divide this whole structure of portrait of the artist? So if you take the first two chapters as a structural unit, then we find that these two chapters together trace the awakening of religious doubts and sexual instincts culminating in the physical experience of the prostitute. So first two chapters can be, talking about religious doubts. So he expresses religious and political. He hears all these religious and political opinions and he comes to have his own doubts about these things. That is there in the first section. First section means like first and second chapters together. And also his awakening sexual instincts, for which he finds a solution by going to a brothel and having sexual intimacy with the prostitute. Next two chapters together, as another structural unit, continue the cycle of sin and repentance. So the sin of having indulged in his lust and the repentance of having committed such acts of lust. The fifth chapter, as a structural unit, stands a little apart in terms of ironic distance. This chapter brings Stephen to the verge of exile and brings to the fore his aesthetic theory and his life goals. This is where he attains his maturity and his outlook on life and his own life goals, the fifth chapter. So basically, it can be divided into three sections. First two chapters taken together, then in the second section, third and fourth chapters together, and the last part would be the fifth chapter on its own. Then, the structure of the portrait of the artist as a young man can divide itself into 19 smaller units marked off through typographical marks. These reveal to Stephen the character of the world that he lives in, the demands this world makes on him, and the corresponding movements within himself that push him towards either succumbing to these demands or rejecting them. So we live in a world where demands are made of us at every step, right? I mean, we cannot live in a vacuum, right? There are demands made on us as individuals by the world around us. So Stephen also feels these demands made on him. And, he can either succumb to these demands or he can reject them. So these different 19 different smaller units talk about what are these demands and how does he react to these demands. Each broad stage of his growth, see, awakening of the body, literary vocation, farewell to Ireland, leaves him lonelier than before. Some of the metaphors that are used to describe the novel's alternations between varying moods are the metaphors of troughs, that is depressions, and crests, that means rising up, like a wave, going down and up. So varying moods of the writer, that is expressed through metaphors of depressions and rises, crests, okay? Almost like a wave pattern, up and down. So pattern of depression and triumph. So going down with depression and going up with the triumph, and he's able to overcome these demands. Fifth chapter can be seen as a relatively static calm as compared to the kinetic frenzies of the preceding four chapters. So the four chapters before the fifth one was full of activity, kinetic frenzy, means like high fevered level of activity. You can see the fifth chapter as a calm chapter where he understands what he wants. And the artist is rationalizing his position and new role, coming to terms with his own identity. A major structuring device is memory. Each unit has chains of images, themes which can be linked to the development of Stephen's identity and his accumulated memory. So memory is one of the devices, okay, structuring devices that is used to connect different aspects in the novel. Another one is structural repetition. So in the novel, see, structural repetition or incremental repetition, it's a favorite device by the modernists, where the motif repeated increasing in symbolic significance as the work proceeds. You might have heard of the word incremental repetition in your poetry, especially when you read ballads. Ballads use this term incremental repetition. There is one line, you know, if it is a song, you know, there are lines that are repeated. But each time that the line is repeated in various stanzas, in this case in the novel, motifs or patterns that are repeated again and again. Each time that is repeated, it adds to the meaning. It increases in its significance. Okay? It increases in its symbolic significance as the work proceeds. So each time you see the symbol, it becomes more and more relevant. So that is another technique that is used, structural repetition. Motif being repeated again and again. By the way, what is a motif? What is the motif?
Aim.
What is it? Did anyone give me an answer?
I think it is aim.
Motif? No, dear. That you're talking about motive, M-O-T-I-V-E. I am talking about M-O-T-I-F, motif. So, motive is aim. I agree. M-O-T-I-V-E, motive is aim. But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about M-O-T-I-F.
Ma'am, a picture on something like that.
Look at a sari, for example. A sari has a motif on it, right? A pattern on it, right? It is repeated again and again, right? That is a motif, right? You see a motif of a flower or a mango or something on a textile, right? Which is repeated. That is a motif. So here in literature, anything, you know, something that is repeatedly used, almost it becomes symbolic in its significance. And each time in James Joyce's book, each time it is used, you know, it becomes more and more important. It gains in its significance when the motif is repeated. Okay. So incremental repetition, where something is repeatedly shown so many times that towards the end, when it is shown, it gains in its importance. Okay. Don't confuse it with motif. Okay. Did you understand the difference?
Yes, ma'am.
Modernist approach, determined to communicate in new and surprising ways by pushing language beyond conventions and ignoring conventional forms of structure. So some part of a portrait may give the impression of just disjointedness, but this disjointedness is actually quite carefully structured. So by the time we come to this novel, we are talking about modernist approaches in writing. And it was an approach that wanted to communicate in new and surprising ways. And one of the ways in which the writers tried to do that, tried to communicate in new ways, was by pushing the limits of language, going beyond the conventions, rules, and regulations of language, and playing with language. You know, ignoring the forms and constructions of language, going beyond all that. So that you find very much part and parcel of this novel, of Portrait of the Artist. And to the extent that when you read it, you might feel that this is disjointed. There is no joint or there's no connection between different sections. But this is not because there is no connection between the two sections, but the author wanted it to be like that. This disjointedness is actually very carefully structured very carefully thought out and made part and parcel of the way in which he wanted to write and present it to us. Then the next one. So point of view, that's the next one. So the next topic is point of view. The question of where another stations himself or herself in relation to his or her main character is quite a crucial one in fiction. That is a point of view, right? From whose point of view are we seeing the story? Are we reading the story? Are we watching the movie? Whichever it is. The destiny of the young artist could be any young man's destiny in Catholic Ireland, especially if the young man was sensitive and had artistic ambitions or pretensions. Any young man, any artistic young man living in Ireland at that point in time would be able to connect with or would be able to find echoes of his own thoughts in the book that James Joyce wrote. So it could be any young man, any artistic young man living in Catholic Ireland at that time. So whose viewpoint do we read in this book? The viewpoint in the book is Stephen's. Yet often ironic discrepancy comes in between Stephen's naive view and the sophisticated readers. So when Stephen talks to us as a naive person means an innocent person who doesn't really understand what is happening. And then when we are reading from Stephen's perspective, from Stephen's point of view, and when we read it from Stephen's point of view, we understand that some of the things that Stephen sees and perceives in a certain way is not correct, because we understand more than Stephen. Stephen is the point of view that we are reading the book from is Stephen's point of view. And Stephen's point of view at times becomes a very naive, innocent person's perspective. So we as sophisticated readers, it doesn't mean we are fashionable, okay? We as readers who understand more than what the character sees are able to see that discrepancy, that sort of ironic discrepancy in Stephen's perception of things. That is what. So we as readers versus the character of Stephen when he narrates what is happening to us. The readers sympathize, feel amused, even annoyed at times with Stephen's immaturity, his vanity, his way of taking himself too seriously, and his fanciful romantic dreams are a constant source of amusement. So we are able to stand apart and look at what Stephen is doing. Sometimes we become amused with what Stephen is doing. Sometimes we become irritated with him, for his immaturity. Sometimes we wonder, how vain is he? How self-obsessed is he? Right? So all of these are emotions that are created in us when we look at the character of Stephen. Stephen had found salvation in deciding on the aesthetic rather than the social, nationalistic or religious orientations in life. So he had tried out all these aspects, right? The social aspect, the nationalistic aspect, he understood what all these was. The religious aspect, he tried with all of that and realized that it's not for me. What is for me is an aesthetic life, the life of an artist. So he had found salvation. He found his solution in deciding on an aesthetic course in his life rather than going for a social, nationalistic or religious way of life. Reserve becomes independence. Pride grows into self-assertion of individuality. And sensitivity develops into the artistic personality, which in the closing stages of the novel, that is the university days, is sufficiently tolerant of others. So the naive, immature Stephen that we see in the earlier sections becomes changed. His reserve, he was a very shy boy. His reserve becomes independence. His pride, which makes him very mature at times, grows into self-assertion of individuality. And the sensitivity that he has, becomes a sensitivity that an artistic personality requires. And so in towards the last part of the novel, we find that he becomes sufficiently tolerant of others. the call of the unfamiliar is always there, and Stephen responds to it most of the time. So there are no risks that he will not take. You know, call of the unfamiliar is not something that he's afraid of. He's ready to go forward. It is thus quite apt that the epigraph of a portrait is from Ovid and denotes the derailer's theme. The epigraph, the beginning part, you know, of a portrait of the artist as a young man, it's from the writings of Ovid, the writer of Metamorphoses. Ovid is known for his writing Metamorphoses. And the epigraph is from there, okay? And it talks about the Daedalus theme. I'll talk about it in a moment. And this is how he begins it, see? And he set his mind to work upon unknown arts. This is how he begins it. So an artist always has to be someone who embraces the unfamiliar, who is not afraid of going forward, seeking the unfamiliar, venturing into unknown territories. So he set his mind to work upon the unknown arts is what Ovid has written, talking about Daedalus. Now we have to know who is this Daedalus. Daedalus was a master craftsman. Okay, there was a king in Greece called Minos. Okay, and his wife Pasiphae had a son who was like a monster. Okay. With the head of a bull and the body of a man. Very violent creature. And Minos, the king, was very ashamed of this son. And he wanted to hide Minos away from the eyes of the public. And he asked Daedalus, this master craftsman, to build a labyrinth. Labyrinth is like a maze. Like, you know, you go through one road, you reach another road, and that will take you to another road. You'll never be able to get out of it. That's called the labyrinth. So Daedalus's master craftsman built a labyrinth and imprisoned Minotaur into that. This monster Minotaur was imprisoned into that. And Minotaur was very violent, and Minos always had to give human sacrifice to Minotaur. Every, you know, a certain period of time, human beings were sent into the labyrinth and the Minotaur would eat them alive. This was happening. And once there was another Greek king called Theseus. He said, I will come and kill the Minotaur. Once they go into the labyrinth, no one could escape the labyrinth. Okay, it was unheard of that anybody had come alive out of the labyrinth. So Theseus comes and says that I will kill the Minotaur. And Theseus goes into the labyrinth. Now, Minos had a daughter called Ariadne. Are you with me? Are you able to understand? I'm saying too many names now. I hope you guys can follow me. Read up, okay? Once I'm saying all these stories, but afterwards you can read up and then it will become more clear. So Theseus goes into the labyrinth saying that I'll kill the Minotaur. And Ariadne, who sees Theseus, falls in love with Theseus and does not want him to be killed in the labyrinth by the Minotaur. So she goes to Daedalus and asks him, what is the secret to come out of the labyrinth alive? And Daedalus explains to her what is the secret to come out of the labyrinth alive. So Theseus goes inside, kills the Minotaur, comes out alive. And this makes Minos very angry because Daedalus broke a promise. Daedalus revealed the secret of the labyrinth to Ariadne. For this, Minos punishes Daedalus. Minos punishes Daedalus by imprisoning him in his own labyrinth. And not only Daedalus is imprisoned with his son Icarus. Okay, so Daedalus and Icarus become in prisoners in the labyrinth. There is no way out of the labyrinth. So Daedalus thinks, what is the way out from this labyrinth? He's a master craftsman, and so he soon comes upon a solution. The solution is that he builds wings for himself and his son, and they escape from the labyrinth using these wings. They fly out from the labyrinth and escape from there. And he tells Icarus, the young boy, okay, your wings are made out of wax. They cannot go near the sun. But Icarus young boy becomes so happy that he is able to fly. He flies close to the sun. His wings melt. He falls into the sea and dies. That's another story. But Daedalus builds the wings and he is able to fly out from the labyrinth. That acquires a symbolic significance because our character, Stephen Daedalus, is given that name Daedalus. Daedalus is a character in Greek mythology who was able to escape from the labyrinth using his wings. Now, Stephen Daedalus in the portrait of the artist is a character who is able to escape from his own surroundings, his own religious, political, social conflicts, right? And escape. And how does he escape? By finding his own theories of aestheticism, by finding his own position as an artist. That is how he escapes. So this becomes deeply symbolic in that sense. Did you understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, good. Then, so sometimes, so this is the story of Daedalus. Okay, very important. And what is it? Yeah. And he said, so this is how it begins. You know, the epigraph of a portrait is from Ovid's Metamorphoses. And denotes the Daedalus theme and he set his mind to work upon unknown arts. And Joyce in a portrait keeps varying his distance from Stephen. Sometimes the two persons emerge, but quite often a distance is kept, though it is never too great, which allows Joyce to bring in irony in the novel. Irony means you say something, but something else is meant by it, right? Irony. So Joyce is able to bring in an ironic distance through using the character of Stephen Daedalus. Although we can say that there are autobiographical elements, it's not an outright autobiography. James Joyce uses the character to bring about a sense of distance also from the character. And like Daedalus, who used his cunning to create unprecedented devices, such as a set of wax wings used to escape from the prison of King Minos, Stephen uses his cunning to create art and a new identity, deresonated from his Irish heritage. So Stephen uses his art to fly out from his surroundings, from his situations, be it his identity as an Irishman, be his political or social or religious anchorages, all of these things. He breaks out of it using his art. But another thing that critics say about James Joyce's work is that though he left Ireland and went to live in Paris and in Switzerland, he died in Switzerland. Though he did all that, though he left Ireland, all his works, to the last work that he has written, you know, the minute you open it, you are in the streets of Dublin. It is Dublin that predominates. It is Ireland that predominates in all the works that he has written. So he is actually, you know, very Irish, although he was not living in Ireland. Then, so this is something in, you know, a pictorial representation which will help you to understand this book more. See, Stephen's growth and personality. The novel deals with tensions and conflicts between Stephen's drive towards adulthood and becoming an artist. Overview, okay, of this novel. Artist comes of age. Basically, this is a story of how an artist comes of age. Now, what are some of the important facts about this? See, relying on a stream of consciousness narrative, rich with sensory detail, a portrait of the artist as a young man describes the journey from childhood to adulthood of Stephen Daedalus, a character based loosely on the author's own development as a writer. Rejecting both despair and piety, Stephen chooses the calling of beauty. So he doesn't get desperate because he's not able to find the kind of clarity that he wants. He doesn't get into that. Neither does he fall for this lure of piety, going the devotional way. He doesn't go for that also. Rather, he opts for the calling of beauty. Calling of beauty is the aesthetic way out through art. Now, as a child, the first part, you find his life divided into different sections there. First part is as a child, then as a youth. Okay, so first part as a child, what you see is over Christmas break, he comes home. There is a dinner that is presented where his elders are all talking about the political situations, and the child becomes aware of all these political situations happening in Ireland and the political leader panel and such situations, and how his father and uncle and others are all connected with that. Then in school, he was bullied and he was also punished unjustly by his teachers. So Stephen witnesses a religious and political argument at home. These are the main things that happened to him as a child. As a young man, as a youth, when Stephen's family moves to Dublin, Stephen becomes disillusioned and alienated as he experiences his first sexual longings. So he becomes an adolescent, a teenager, and he feels quite, you know, out of any kind of circle. He feels lonely, and he also does not know what to do with these feelings of sexual longings that he has. So that is how he ends up with the prostitute. This is the next stage. See, sinner. With the growing fear of hell, Stephen frequents prostitutes and indulges in other sinful behavior. And eventually he goes to confession. So he thinks that by confession, by this Catholic confession, he might be able to make amends for all the sins that he has committed. So the next stage in his life is that of a sinner. And he wants to very badly make amends for whatever he has done, because he feels afraid of all the sins that he has committed. So he goes into the next stage, that of a saint. Following a strict religious practice, Stephen considers entering the priesthood, but decides to devote his life to beauty instead. So finding his vocation is not priesthood, but rather a life devoted to a study of beauty, or rather an aesthetic life. So finds his calling as an artist. So Stephen develops his aesthetic theory, rejecting all outside influences that would interfere with his identity as an artist. So the artist finding his own identity, which makes this a Kunstlroman, like we said earlier. Remember? This is a novel in the genre Bildungsroman, but more particularly, this is a Kunstlroman, because this is about an artist coming of age. And he comes of maturity not by, you know, devoting himself to a useful life, but rather by rejecting every other aspect of life and following the path of art. So that's why this is a Kunstlroman. I'm going on. You can see Stephen Dedalus, the character there, conflicted young man. He becomes an artist. And some of the other characters you meet in this book are Emma Clary, Stephen's feminine ideal. Then there is Simon Dedalus, proud, sentimental father, bad with money, which his own father also was, you know, very bad with money. Then you have Cranley, his friend and confidant at the university, and urges Stephen to fit in. Stephen does not fit in, and Stephen becomes uncomfortable when he doesn't fit in. So that is Cranley. And then you have Mary Dedalus, Stephen's pious mother. Now, what are the conflicts and rising action? Like, if you analyze the book, you know, from the point of view of a free tax pyramid. Free tax pyramid, we discussed earlier, I think, you know, where you're introduced to characters and introduced to conflicts when the action rises until it reaches a point of conflict. And then through the conflict, or it reaches climax, where you find the climax leads to falling action, where the conflicts are resolved, leading to resolution and final tying up of all loose ends, which is what we call as denouement. Okay, so here, what are the major conflicts here? See, the major conflict is Stephen's struggle to decide whether he should be loyal to his family, his church, his nation, or his vocation as an artist. The action rises to a conflict when Stephen encounters prostitutes. His emotional reaction to Father Arnold's hellfire sermons, his temporary devotion to religious life, his realization that he must confront the decision of whether to center his life around religion or art. So when he decides to become a priest, you know, there is, it is following a retreat that he has. where he listens to this priest called Father Arnell talking about hell and hellfire, which really disturbs him. Then the climax, you know, is reached when Stephen's decision in chapter 4 to reject the religious life in favor of life and as an artist. So he's almost on the point of becoming a priest when he sees, you know, a group of gentlemen singing merrily and passing outside the door. And then he suddenly, you know, he realizes this is this life of the priest is not for me, because it does not talk about joys of life. It's a very dull life. And then he rejects this life of priesthood and decides to devote his life to becoming an art. And the following action comes, following action leading to resolution, comes with Stephen's enrollment in the university college, where he gradually forms his aesthetic theory, Stephen's distancing of himself from his family, church, and nation. Again, like Kunstler romance, he rejects that which does not suit his ideas and ideals or aims in life. His family, church, and nation, he rejects all that to follow his pursuit to become an artist. So that is how you can analyze the novel, you know, into its various points. Now, the narrator in this novel, the narrator is anonymous, speaks with the same voice and tone that Stephen might. Okay? So changes with changes in Stephen's situation and life. And whose point of view do we see? The most of the most part of this novel is in the third person, using he, she, etc. The point of view is that of Stephen. So as Stephen develops as a person, the language and perspective of the narration develops with him. We see everything in the manner in which he thinks and feels. So we are seeing the world through Stephen's eyes, through Stephen's words. So whatever he feels, whatever he thinks, that's what we also see. At the very end of the novel, there is a brief section in which the story is told through Stephen's diary entries. This section is in the first person. So the last part, that's the only section which is in the first person, I, me, etc. Because we are reading the diary entries of Stephen. And what is the tone that you find in the novel? The tone is generally serious and introspective, especially during Stephen's several heartfelt epiphanies. Epiphanies is also another part of this novel, an important aspect of this novel. Epiphanies are like revelations, you know, something that happens which brings about an image in his mind which leads to clarity in his thoughts. That is an epiphany. So like a revelation. So the tone is generally serious, especially when Stephen has these epiphanies. The tense that is used is in the past tense, and setting is primarily Dublin and the surrounding areas. And the protagonist is Stephen Dedalus. Protagonist is, means, the word protagonist means central character. The opposite of a protagonist, or rather the conflicting character, would become the antagonist. Now we're going to read, you know, like in more detail about the novel. Just see how it is divided. First section of chapter 1 shows Stephen at home in his infancy, reference to bedwetting and the warm and cold feelings that go with it, his father's heavy face and his mother's smell, which is nicer than his father's, are catalogued. You see how sensory it is, right? The way in which he describes it. Smells and softness, and you know, the sensation of wet and cold and warm and hot, and all of these very sensory. His writing is very sensory. Then section 2 shows life at Clongowes School. Associations, again, you find this repeated. Associations of cold and wet sensations, sense of smells are brought in. So smell, for example, smells of peasants in the church, Christmas dinner at home, political matters are discussed. They talk about Parnell and the issues of Parnell. Coldness and whiteness reminds him of Eileen's hands. Stephen is unjustly caned by Father Dolan, calls Stephen a lazy, idle little loafer. These are things that happen in the first beginning part of the novel, you know, how the teacher punishes him and he feels very humiliated with that. the sound of the cricket bats from the playground. See, again, another sensory image. The cricket bat, you know, the ball hitting the cricket bat. You know how he described it? Tick, pack, pock, pock. I mean, it's like that, right? Imagine the sound of a ball hitting the cricket bat. This is exactly the sound you would hear, right? Tick, pack, pock, pock. Like drops of water in a fountain falling softly in a brimming bowl. So look at the way that is described. Then section 2 of the second chapter begins with his removal to Dublin, a new complex sensation. Stephen has a tram ride with Emma. Emma is a girl with whom he was supposed to go for a party, and he goes on this tram ride with her, and he has a very beautiful, lovely sensation. See, his heart danced upon her movements like a cork upon a tide. So bobbing up and down, you know, they were playing on the steps of the tram, going up and down a step. And he was very happy, and his heart was dancing upon her movements. One of his friends, Emma. In section 3 of chapter 2, the life that he had at Belvedere is described. And he waits for Emma to come and see him in the play, but she doesn't come. He becomes very dejected. He's taking part, is acting in a play in school, and he expects Emma, the girl, to come and see him, but she doesn't, and he becomes very dejected. In section 4 of chapter 2, Stephen visits Cork with his father. Father and son visit Queen's College. The sight of the word fetus cut in the dark stained wood of a desk has a powerful effect on Stephen. That again sparks off another train of thoughts. In section 5 of chapter 2, Stephen wins a prize, and the prize money leads to shocked euphoria. He treats his entire family. Feeling restless, he visits a prostitute. So that is also the section where this sense of restlessness overtakes him, and he finds some sort of relief in the arms of a prostitute. The first two chapters complete the first major stage in Stephen's growth, with his proper initiation into sexuality. The following two chapters shows him feeling guilty on the score. Section 1 of chapter 3, Stephen is still not out of his nocturnal wanderings in the squalid quarter of the brothels. So that area of the city where there are these brothels. So Stephen, in that section also, so you can see Stephen still frequenting those places, various brothels. Then section 2 of chapter 3 contains the three sermons. So that's when he listens to the sermons by Father Arnold. He feels overwhelmed by the sermons about hell. It really upsets him. In section 3 of chapter 3, Stephen returns home in self-disgust and terror. After confession in the chapel, he finds peace. So he definitely feels that, you know, he has committed unforgivable sins, and he tries to find some salvation by confession. Being a Catholic, he believes in confession. Then in section 1 of the fourth chapter, there is a change in Stephen's day-to-day life. He follows a rigorous discipline of prayer and self-mortification. Here, Joyce shows Stephen drifting further and further away from reality, subordinating the real to the ideal. So he is so taken up with this, thought of having committed sin and wanting to move away from that he goes into this further and further away from reality, into more a life that he thinks is ideal. And in the next section 2 of the fourth chapter, the director of studies summons Stephen for a possibility of priesthood. So he lives such an austere life, such a very, life of self-mortification, where he does not give himself any kind of pleasures. He leads such a strict and austere life that in the next chapter, the director of studies calls him, tells him that you have a chance to become a priest. And so this is a quotation from there. How often had he seen himself as a priest, wielding calmly and humbly the power of which angels and saints stood in reverence. The temptation exercised by priesthood is, however, temporary. So this is very attractive, it really tempts him. It's not something that holds his attention always, because just as he is at the door taking leave of the director, he sees four young men striding past, arms linked, singing to a concertina. This contrast between the sight and that happy sight, you know, the happy sight of four young men walking by, their arms linked together and singing happily, that is contrasted with the face of the unhappy priest, you know, the mirthless mask of the priest's face, mirthless mask, no joy in it, no smile on it. The mirthless mask of the priest's face stirs in Stephen an instinct of recoiling from the cold orderliness of Jesuit life. The threat to his freedom that such a vocation stands for decides him against it. So suddenly this, it's again like another epiphany when he sees these four boys going by, you know, he suddenly realizes that this is not the life that I want, you know, this mirthless life of a priest is not what I want. And he decides that, you know, that it would interfere with his freedom, and he goes, you know, he rejects it. He rejects the possibility of becoming a priest. He was aware that his destiny was to be elusive of social or religious orders. So he becomes conscious that his future did not lie in following any social order or religious order. He wanted to learn through his own mistakes. Section 3 of the chapter 4 shows Stephen waiting for his father. He senses the destiny prophetically represented by Dedalus. So he makes this connection with himself and Dedalus. He senses that. So Dedalus, as we discussed earlier, is a figure from Greek mythology, a craftsman who built the labyrinth of Crete. He also made things for himself and his son Icarus. So the name is associated with transcendence. Transcendence means rising above, right? So just as Dedalus, using his wings, was able to rise above the labyrinth where he was imprisoned, our Stephen was able to use the power of art and artistic endeavor to rise above the things that imprisoned him, whether it is social order or religious order. Later, Stephen takes off shoes and stockings and goes down to the sand. So he goes to the waterside. He takes off his shoes and goes into the sand. And there he sees another powerful image that completely moves him. He sees a girl wading in midstream, staring out into the sea. She has a striking girlish beauty and she looks at him lingeringly. Her eyes had called him. And the soul had leaped at the call. The message is clear: to live, to err, to fall, to triumph, to recreate life out of life. This becomes his motto in life. This becomes the force, the driving force in his life. So when he sees this girl, a beautiful girl, you know, standing, wading in the water and looking at him, his soul leaps at the call. He realizes that this is the moment of revelation. This becomes, you know, what he is meant for, the purpose in his life becomes clear to him, another moment of epiphany for him. And he realizes that the message in his life is to live, to err. Err means to make mistakes, to fall down, you know, and still to rise up again. So there will be failures, there will be mistakes, yet to learn from that and live life. That is what my life is all about. He realizes that. So this experience is almost a resurrection. Okay. So it's almost like, you know, rising from the dead for him. Now, section 2 of chapter 5, we have from Stephen a poem to Emma that is an artificial product of literary and religious verbalism. He knows a break must be made from Emma and he decides to leave. He makes a clear statement of his faith. I will not serve that in which I no longer believe, whether it call itself my home, my fatherland, my church, and I will try to express myself in some mode of life or art as freely as I can and as wholly as I can, using for my defense the only arms I allow myself to use, silence, exile, and cunning. Cunning doesn't mean negative sense. Cunning means cleverness, okay? What a writer would use, you know, the artifice or the creation part of it. Cunning here refers to cultivating craftsmanship, and the other two terms, that is silence and exile, refer to his not being afraid of being isolated on his quest of the freedom that he sees essential for the artist. So the path of an artist is often a very lonely one, you know. So now he is grown up enough and strong enough to understand that, and he is sure that he will be able to face this life of exile or isolation. So So that is what you find in section 2 of chapter 5. Finally, in section 4 of chapter 5, the last of the 19 sections that this novel is built around, you know, we have scraps from Stephen's journal for the time prior to his actual departure from Dublin. The overall portrait that emerges from the novel is that of an extra-sensitive, proud, isolated individual who has in him what is needed for the making of an artist rather than the artist. His continuous searches for warmth, for experience, for its own sake, for transcendence of a kind, for getting away and for being on the move. The cry that Stephen finally utters at the end of the book, "Welcome, O life." Remember the dying words in our last novel that we studied, the dying words of Kurtz. Does anyone remember? The dying words of Kurtz from the last novel.
The horror, I think, ma'am. Very good.
I'm so happy. Yes, very good. I'm happy. Very happy to get these answers. So as a teacher, it makes me very happy when I understand that you've been listening, you know, because it is online. I don't see you guys and I'm just speaking into the void here, you know. So I get very happy when I hear these answers. Thank you. So, the last cry that you see here, Stephen uttering in the end of his book is, "Welcome, O life." How different from Kurtz's words, right? "Welcome, O life." So he's breaking out of everything that had restricted him and embracing this, life of an artist, which he knows is not an easy one, yet he's embracing it with the words, "Welcome, O life." Now, we also have to talk about Stephen's aesthetic theories, okay? What was it based on? Now, three main principles of the theory of aesthetics put forward by Stephen are, so art is a stasis. Art is like inactivity or equilibrium, which is brought about by formal rhythm of beauty. So kind of steadiness brought about by this rhythm of beauty. Then art of beauty divorced from good and evil is akin to truth. So beauty divorced from good and evil is similar to truth. The three qualities of beauty which correspond to the three stages of apprehension are in terms of Aquinas. He was influenced by Aquinas. And these three qualities of beauty which correspond to the three stages of apprehension, of understanding, in the terms of Aquinas, are like this. Three terms are there which you have to understand. One of the terms is integritas, which means wholeness. And the second term is consonantia, which means harmony. And the third term is claritas, which means radiance. So Stephen's ideas about, you know, aesthetic ideas are based on words by St. Thomas Aquinas, who was a 13th century saint. Pure art exists as a delicate balance between the art object and the one who perceives it. So that is what is pure art, okay? It exists as a balance between the object and the one who perceives it. Like we have heard Keats saying, beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder, similar to that. You know? So the pure art is what lies in how it is apprehended by the object and how it is apprehended by the viewer or by the one who perceives it, understands. Stephen's interpretation of consonantia, the term that Aquinas used, accords generally with due proportion that Aquinas notes as a characteristic of beauty. So everything has its due proportion. That is how Stephen interprets consonantia. When Stephen is talking of claritas in a portrait, there is a substitution of quiditas for claritas. Quiditas means the whatness of a thing. What is it? Understanding the whatness of a thing. What exactly is this? Right? So not really understanding the due proportion for balance, also understanding the essentiality of it, the whatness of a thing, which he uses the word quiditas. And as for integritas, Stephen translates it as wholeness. But what is nearer to his meaning is perfection, the wholeness of a thing or its perfection. So Stephen's interpretation see artwork as a world in itself, with the appropriate standards of completeness, harmony, and clarity. This is how his aesthetic theory is formulated. So, applying standards of completeness, harmony, and clarity, rather than as a fragment or a symbol of a broader and more extensive unity. So he sees a work of art as something which is complete and harmonious and clear in itself, not as part of an extensive unit. Now, truth satisfies the intellect, while beauty satisfies the imagination. The beautiful affects the mind. The mind is seized by its wholeness and fascinated by its harmony and enchanted by its radiance. So this, we can say, is the aesthetic theory of Stephen Dedalus. Okay? So truth is something that satisfies the intellect and beauty satisfies the imagination. But what is beautiful affects the mind, and mind is seized by its wholeness, and mind becomes fascinated by the harmony and also by the clarity, the radiance that it exudes. The radiance that it sends out, exudes and sends out. Then the next section. Hold on, just a second. Yeah, Stephen and the women characters, okay? Now, women characters in the book, okay? There is his mother, there is his nanny, and there is also the early friend that, the nanny Dante, and his early friend called Eileen, okay? And then, apart from them, you know, there is this romantic dream that he has about Mercedes. He reads this novel called The Count of Monte Cristo by Alexander Dumas, the same one who wrote The Three Musketeers. Okay, so he reads this book, and there is this character called Mercedes in this, and he has his romantic dreams about the character. So the women characters that you see appearing in this novel, mother is there, Dante is there, Eileen is there, Mercedes is there. The next person from the opposite sex to figure in Stephen's life is Emma, the girl, you know, the friend with whom he took a tram ride, the girl whom he meets at the party at Harold's Cross. The sexuality in this relationship is diverted by his experience with the prostitute. So there is no sexuality in this relationship, but that is kind of, you know, taken care of by how he goes to the prostitute. After a cycle of sin and guilt, the waiting girl becomes for him a way out of his dilemma. She becomes the catalytic agent for creativity. So she becomes something that gives him the push towards creativity. This girl standing in the water, she raises her dress and wades into the water. That image, you know, becomes for him a way out of his dilemma. Now, he's generally awkward with women characters. He's awkward with girls. His aloofness from most of his compatriots at school, means classmates at school and university, is partly timidity, partly a feeling of self-importance. So it's not all timidity. He's very shy, but he's also aware, like, he has this feeling that he's better than everyone else. So self-importance. His notions about what an artist should be like also contribute to his isolation. The encounter with the prostitute offers him knowledge and certainty which he doesn't get with Emma. Although he feels attracted to Emma, the kind of certainty and the kind of experiences that he wants, he doesn't get with Emma. That's what he gets from the prostitute. Women are strong maternal figures for Stephen. So for Stephen Dedalus, women are maternal figures. Woman as an image has two meanings for Stephen. One, as possessive stumbling blocks in his movement towards artistic freedom. For example, his mother, Eileen, Mercedes, etc. So the kind of attachment, you know, for example, with his mother, and also the sense of being a block in his movement towards, you know, artistic freedom, and he wants total freedom. So these are women who hold him back, he feels, you know, his mother, his Eileen, Mercedes, etc. Mother, there is this emotional bond, especially even in Joyce's real life, you know. He at that by the time his mother was a very devout Catholic, but by the time she died, Joyce had started questioning religion and all its aspects. So he could not, he felt he could not really offer her any solace or any comfort. And his father by that time had become such a drunk that he also was completely, able to do nothing for his mother. So that experience is there, and that also kind of reflects itself in this book. The other view is as a source of enlightenment. For example, the waiting girl and before her the prostitute. So women who either are hindrances or are sources of enlightenment for him. And sources of enlightenment are two. One is the prostitute who gives him knowledge and a sort of understanding about himself. And also this other one is the waiting girl who offers him clarity. Who, seeing her standing in the water is a moment of clarity, of revelation, of an epiphany for him. So this is his relationship with women characters. Now, technique, the styles that he employs. So James Joyce uses a different style in each section to underline each section of Stephen's development. Each style is meant to represent a different stage in Stephen's progress towards the final realization of his true vocation. And by selection and patterning of language, Joyce is able to mimic the growth of the child's mind. So, patterning language to mimic the growth of the child's mind. Because first, when you start reading the novel, this is how it begins. See, once upon a time, at a very good time it was, there was a moo cow coming down the road. And this moo cow that was coming along down the road met a nicest little boy named Baby Taku. I mean, imagine we were telling a story to a little child, right? This is the way in which we would narrate. So he begins this novel, exactly the way in which a little baby would be told a story. So how he uses language. As the child grows, the idiom changes and the range of interests becomes wider, that of a schoolboy. Schoolboy slang is introduced. At that point, the language of the novel changes and schoolboy slang is introduced. For the Christmas dinner episode, we are stepping into the world of adults. We find Joyce taking recourse to a dramatic, impersonal mode. Why? Because Stephen is listening to the world of the elders, the grown-up people. So the language changes accordingly. When Stephen roams the back streets of Dublin's brothel district, there is a subtle change in style. So his way of speaking also changes when he's wandering amongst the prostitutes. When we come to the sermons, another kind of rhetoric takes over. Rhetoric in the sense here, language. So when he goes to the priest, listens to religious sermons, another kind of language takes over. One of the climatic epiphanies in the novel is represented by the sight of the waiting girl, and its effect on Stephen conveys the buoyancy. So the waves and the falling and rising, the buoyancy that he feels, how his heart rises up when he sees the image of this girl, wading in the water. That's one of the climaxes. The variety of styles that we come across in the portrait is quite functional and tailored to different stages of Stephen's growth. The broad progression of style is from a kind of interior monologue of the infant through growing objectivity to the adolescent lyricism of the vision of the waiting girl. Then there is a broad humor, and finally, there are these diary jottings that amount to some kind of shorthand for the interior monologue form associated with stream of consciousness. This is the way in which the language is used, depending on the stage that he is in that moment in life, the language changes. Then, repetitions and symbolism. Repetition is a stylistic and structural device which many modern writers use. The function of repetition of images, symbol, and motif in a portrait is most of the time only suggestive and not definitive. So things that you find repeatedly used by the writer, it has a symbolic meaning also. For example, you will find these symbols coming up again and again. This symbols, motifs, etc., coming up again and again. Birds, water, and colors. Now, water. See, what does it signify? Okay. See, wet, dry, bog water. I mean, bog water is marshy water. Squalor, dirty bath water. All of these things come at various stages in the novel. So this image of the motif of water is repeated at various points. You can see the wetness of water, the dirtiness of water, all these aspects of water. Bath water, dirty bath water. What does it see? It's also liberating in episode of the wading girl. So you find the sensation of cold water. You find the dirt associated with dirty bath water. You find the muddy, marshy water, and also you find the clear water in which this girl is wading, which is a symbol of liberation there. So all kinds of symbols can be associated. So another prominent image that comes is the in different colors that are used. There is green of Ireland, rational color, Ireland, Parnell. So all of these, is associated with the color of green. Red is associated with family heart. Then wading girl's colors are ivory and blue. And Eileen's hands are also ivory. So these are also symbolic there. Then you find different birds also talked about. There are eagles pull out Stephen's eyes. He thinks as a child that eagles will pull out his eyes. Bird images later associated with flight and transcendence. So Daedalus himself is associated with flight, right? So bird images come more and more. Then there is also, this transcendence. When you talk about transcendence of rising higher and higher, you also have this image of Icarus rising above the water. Then wading girl image. Icarus is the son of Daedalus. You also have this image of a wading girl that has transformed into a seabird. So birds and flight. Then two more symbols that are employed by James Joyce, flowers and roads. Rose symbol, roads as symbolic of walks, wandering, etc. Then connotations of his symbols keep changing. So depending on the situation, the meaning of the symbols change. Then the next one is stream of consciousness and epiphanies. How does he employ epiphanies? Okay. Epiphanies and stream of consciousness method is on the psychic being of the characters and the associative mode by association. In the opening and the closing pages, the inner aspect of this consciousness is on view. The story of the boo cow is linked in Stephen's consciousness with Burns sweet shop. A memory of his father leads to a memory of his mother. Associations lead us to Eileen. The coldness of the bed and its wetness are all part of this associative process. So stream of consciousness basically is about association. One thing leading to the other. Like for example here, a memory of his father leads to memory of his mother. And then when you talk about Eileen, associations lead us to Eileen. And then even the coldness of the bed and its wetness are all associated for him. So it changes, according to the association that rises in his mind. And then again, role of epiphany. So the next one is role of epiphany in this novel. By an epiphany, Joyce meant a sudden spiritual manifestation or showing forth. A portrait incorporates a sequence of related epiphanies in the form of a forward-moving narrator. So there are many epiphanies that you see here. Okay, the estuary epiphany is the most notable example of the girl wading in the water. Stephen has a flash of insight, recognizes the call of his artistic vocation, which becomes transfigured into the form of the wading girl. This becomes for him the embodiment of art and beauty. So epiphany in the portrait of the artist as a young man is a very important thing. Okay, please do read up about it. Then linguistic features. Okay, there are tight structures of modification. He uses adjectives, adverbs, adjective phrases, adverbial phrases, then adjective clauses, adverb clauses, etc. The aim is to give us as exact a description as possible. What are adjectives? What are adjectives? Anyone? You heard of the word adjective, right? Hello. Have you heard of the word adjective?
Ma'am, the verb which qualifies a noun.
Okay. Absolutely, yes. Give me an example.
Like a beautiful girl, big house. So here, yeah, big and beautiful are adjectives.
Yes, yes. So what she mentioned, that is correct, absolutely correct. So a noun is a name, right? So suppose I say girl, and I say, what kind of girl is she? Beautiful girl. So that word beautiful, which qualifies the noun, is what is an adjective. And an adverb similarly is a word that qualifies a verb. Verb is an action verb, right? Writing. Writing fast, right? So it's qualifying how he's writing. So that becomes an adverb. A word that qualifies a verb becomes an adverb. A word that qualifies a noun becomes an adjective. So yeah, he uses all of these things to add to his descriptive elements. Okay. Then going on further, critical perspectives. Okay, early critics felt the book to be too chaotic, yet some saw merit in it. Example, poet Hart Crane found it spiritually inspiring. The writer H.G. Wells saw it as by far the most living and convincing picture that exists of an Irish Catholic upbringing. And critics like Harry Levin have praised him for providing the transition of author's mind from the transition from photographic realism to aesthetic impressions, which is very important as far as writers is concerned, right? Because they could go to another level of expression where they can talk about impressions, right? The interior transformations happening in the mind of the writers. Then James Atherton draws attention to cinematic elements in Joyce's narrative techniques. A modernist novel can be approached by psychoanalytic insights of Jacques Lacan, Lacanian theory. Tying up selfhood, the unconscious. Lacan sees novelistic characters as assemblages or signifiers, always mobile, clustering around the proper name. So Lacan sees novelistic characters as signifiers, you know. Signifiers are kind of like names, you know, that signify something. Now these words get meaning only if we associate it with something, right? So that's what I've explained here. The linguistic sign, which belongs to language. Okay, the linguistic sign, which belongs to language. For example, I say dog, right? Which belongs to language. Establishes a relationship between an acoustic waveform or a signifier and a concept or signifier. When I say dog, I'm establishing a relationship, right, between this word that comes out of my mouth and a concept or what is signified, right? By the word dog, D-O-G, when I write the letters together and say the word dog, I am talking about this concept of what is signified. The dog, right? A sign taken in isolation does not define a meaning. When I just say dog, if I take it in isolation, it does not have any meaning. Only when I say it loud and when I think of a particular dog. When I say dog, we all have different images in our mind when I say anything. I say tree, right? Or a dog or a cat or whatever. We all have different images, right? So a sign taken in isolation does not define a meaning. A signifier can refer to several signifiers. The dog that I think about is another dog. the dog that you think about is another dog. So a signifier can refer to several signifiers. So that psychoanalytic insights of Yaks Lacan, tying up selfhood and unconscious, you know, to novelistic characters, that is reflected in the novel here. Then personality is not something static, but a succession of phases. So for our personality, like the sign that we talked about now, is also not static, right? It changes, succession of phases. Different modes of Stephen's thoughts react to his environment. The arrangement of overall structure is an arrangement of technique. Different situations require different rhythms and modes of thoughts, and focuses on the movement, which involves a shift between moment of stasis, that is no movement, moment of stasis. Moment of stasis means no action, no movement, at which perception fixes on epiphanies at the end of each narrative unit. So this is the way in which he structures it. And epiphanies are moments of sudden revelation or realization. Each chapter ends with a sense of passing through or passing on. And Stephen achieves a transcendence that links him closer to Joyce. So the character is somehow rising above to become more and more connected with the author himself. So Stephen's progress in the portrait are rites of sundering and reconciliation. Rites of sundering. Sundering means breaking apart. Actions of cutting away and also coming back together, reconciliation. In psychoanalytic approach, sundering is tied up with lack and desire. Sin for Stephen becomes, it comes to be an activity through which he develops himself by being shaken loose from an established context. And language is a structure through which he understands himself. Sense of separation and loss expand Stephen's language, moving back and forth between an attractive maternal image and a threatening paternal one. Psychoanalytic interpretations of the character, see? A sense of separation and loss, and his language also changes accordingly. Maternal image is associated with love, and the paternal one is associated with threatening images. So contact with the maternal flux has a way of energizing Stephen at crucial points in the text. And Joyce's techniques of parody and pastiche, self-referentiality, fragmentation of word and image, open-ended narrative, multiple points of view have impacted later writers and media. When you read this novel, you will find all these elements in the novel. Joyce uses all these elements, parody and pastiche, self-referentiality, talking about himself, then words and images, fragmented, and open-ended narrative. There is no definite ending. It's very open-ended. It's one of the characteristics of modern novels, open-endedness, and multiple points of view. All of these things are part and parcel of his writing, and they have actually influenced the writers after him also, and also in media. You know? And I mentioned a word there, pastiche. What does it mean? See, it's pronounced pastiche. Okay? It's a creative work that imitates another author or genre. It's a way of paying respect or honor to great works of the past. Pastiche differs from parody in that pastiche isn't making fun of the works it imitates. However, the tone of pastiche is humorous. So parody, you all have heard, I'm sure you've all heard of that, right? Parody is imitating, making fun of. Pastiche is also imitating, but it's not making fun of. Okay, it's not ridiculing it. Although there is a humorous tone that comes in, it's not ridiculing that. So pastiche is imitation. So Joyce introduced trivial details of an ordinary life into the realm of art, and just a moment, I can't see the So Joyce introduced trivial details of ordinary life into the realm of art and opened up a rich new territory for writers, painters, filmmakers to explore the complexities of the writer's mind. So that's how we finish the discussion of this novel. So stream of consciousness technique, very important as far as James Charles's novel is concerned. So I'm going to end my discussion of this with that. Yeah, so stop sharing that and so if there's something that you want to ask me, we can. Shall I call it a day?
Yeah, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I see the message. One second. Let me in call messages. Let me check that. Okay. When I teach, you know, actually, I've not been able to check your in call messages. I'll just read it now. Okay. Somebody has asked me, AJJ. Who's that, AJJ? Will you please share these notes in WhatsApp? Yes, I will. I will share these notes. And also, I will share more links, actually. I always do that after each class. I always do that. I share this PowerPoint thing on the WhatsApp group. And I also share more information, whatever useful links that you can have, you know, to help you in your study, help you to understand the novel. I always try to do that. Mostly, I try to share, you know, things from YouTube that you can watch and listen and understand easily. Last class also, I had done that. I hope, like, you know, some of you are joining the group even, I think, after I put these links. But then I hope there are others who are sharing this in your general group. I'm sure you're doing that, right? So that way, it will benefit everyone. So after this also, I'll put the PowerPoint thing in the group, you know, I'll put that in the group. All right then. Anything else? So shall I call it today then?
Yes, ma'am.
You're welcome. Thank you to everyone for staying with me till the end. I know it's not easy to listen, right? Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Christina, Preeta, Anju.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you, Ashish. Thank you. All right, then. Bye-bye. See you next week.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Happy weekend.
Thank you, ma'am.
You too. You too. Bye-bye.